everybody. We have Matthias, and he'll be speaking about GDK Plus.
Can everybody hear me okay?
Okay,
good. So, this is the GDK talk. This year's GRADEC. I've been giving a GDK talk like almost every GRADEC in the last 3 years. And usually it was either like a state of the union, basically what say what have we been doing in the last year, or kind of a baby talk where we say like, this is where we want to go. So for this year, I felt it was something a little different, and this is what I came up with. The topic is GDK can do this, and I hope I assembled an entertaining list of kind of small tips and tricks that you maybe did not know yet that GDK can do really easily, and maybe a quick show of who here in the room has worked with GDK in the past, like has written an application or potential application. Okay, so that's almost everybody. So that makes the challenge a little harder. I hope that at the end of the talk, everybody can say that at least one of the things I showed here today was something that maybe they hadn't really seen done before or didn't know about. So there will be a lot of improvised demos for this, and some things will go wrong, but that makes it more entertaining, I hope. So getting started here. First group of examples is about scrolling. We've been doing a lot of work on scrolling in the last few years. We've introduced overlay scroll bars, introduced kinetic scrolling, smooth scrolling, and all of this, of course, with the goal to make the experience better and to have a better touch experience on the one hand, and to make scrolling work more naturally with really large documents, and to give better feedback to the users about where they are when they're scrolling. And all of these things hopefully contribute to that. And I was going to demonstrate some of these as a first example. Let's see if this works. This is GDK demo, which most of you have hopefully seen before. And I just try to make a scroll bar key here. So that's the overlay scroll bar aspect of it. The scroll bar pops up as you get closer, and then you can use it by clicking. You jump there if you do a back. If you do a shift click, you can scroll by pages as you used to. And something that I fairly recently added is if you right click, you get smooth scrolling with an extra twist. If you move the mouse away, the thing gets faster. So that can hopefully be useful at some point. I've added this smooth scrolling feature in a way as a replacement for the steppers that we usually have, like those little buttons at the beginning and at the end of the scroll bar, which let you do this kind of thing. You just click the button and then the thing would keep scrolling. And we kind of lost that when we lost the steppers. But thankfully, steppers are not entirely dead yet. So I'll go back to my slides here. Steppers are not entirely dead. You can still get them back if you want. And it's as easy as adding a little CSS snippet. You can add it to your .config gdk-3.0 gdk CSS file, or you can add it to your application-specific CSS if you want. And I'm going to try to demonstrate that live, and that'll be exciting. There's my inspector. So using gdk inspector, you hopefully know about this tool right now. It lets you live edit all kinds of things, and also CSS. So I'll try to copy the thing you just saw on the slide. And if I make a typo here, please tell me. Also see, we have nice error underlining here, so you know when you misspell something too early. So for now, nothing changed, but if you get the scroll bar back, you'll see that it now has those little buttons back here at the bottom. And if I manage to click on one, maybe the lower one here, it does basically the same thing that this smooth scrolling did before. There's two speeds. This is the slow speed, and if I use the right mouse button, you get the fast speed. And unfortunately, middle button click on this thing doesn't really work, but if you manage to get a click in, that'll jump to the end. And the other button obviously goes in the other direction. And if you remember how steppers worked in GTK 2 and earlier GTK 3, this is also better than it used to be because we're now using the smooth scrolling that's integrated with the frame string, so we're basically drawing as smooth as we can with the current GTK drawing technology, updating every frame. Okay, going back to my slides. There's more to scroll bars, and this is really just an example to show off that you can do this. I'm not sure that having context menus on scroll bars is a great UI. I'm looking at Alan here, but if you need, you can. So let me show how that works. So let's go here. I'm now right-clicking on the slider, and there's a menu, and it does something. So just added two actions to this menu, basically jump to the start or jump to the end. If the need arises, it's very easy to add. And if I get back to my slides, show you how. So for that, you just use the GTK widget pop-up menu signal. Basically, every widget has a signal, and scroll bars actually emit the signal if you right-click on the slider, and then you can add a callback there that pops up a menu or does something else. All right, so much for scrolling. Moving on to another thing that we recently added to GTK, actually, but that's something that's new this cycle. And to explain what output-only windows are, where they would be useful, I need to like tell a little bit of a backstory here, give some background. In X11, if you have like a window hierarchy like the one I tried to outline here, you have a parent window and you have two overlapping child windows. And you click in that place there where I showed that X will send that event to the child 1 window. And if that child 1 window does not handle the event, it will propagate from child to the parent. So the next window to like handle it will be the parent window. Which is probably not what you want if in this constellation, if child 2 is an active UI element like a button and child 1 was just some decorative drawing or something, some ornament. In that case, you probably would have preferred the event to go to the widget that is physically underneath in the stacking order. But that's not what, X gives us. So what to do? Of course, X has a very robust problem. You can set input shapes on windows. And what that means is that you can basically associate a little bit of extra information with the window child 1 here, and you can tell X that only this outline area here is going to be visible for input. And if you click on in that area there, it'll appear to X as if you actually clicked on the underlying window child 2, and that way you get the desired effect. So that's the X story. Now GTK doesn't actually use X windows very much nowadays. It mostly uses client-side windows for everything. But of course, when we implemented client-side windows, we faithfully implemented most of the X window semantics, so our client-side windows have more or less the same problem. And so we need some kind of fix to support this sort of decoration overlay. And turns out that was actually fairly easy, so Alex added a pass-through property to GTK window, which basically just implements the simplest possible case of input shape. It's like an all or nothing. Either the window does receive events or it does not receive any events anywhere, which is good enough for most real world use cases. And on the GTK side, the widget where that's most likely to be a useful thing to have is GTK overlay, where you're basically already creating one widget overlaying other widgets. And so we added a child property there, also called pass-through, which you can set on child windows to make them transparent for input, and then you can use them for for just as for the drawing and use it as decorations essentially without affecting input. And that could look like something like this. We're able to just use an image for this, and I actually have a live demo that then shows you that. So let's switch back to GDK demo one more time. And find this demo. So it is. So there's a text view, and it has an overlay with like two GDK images. One sits here at the top and one sits here at the bottom. And just to demonstrate that this is actually transparent for input, I can actually reduce the margin here. And you can see the text slides under this, and I can still type here and say something like, and as you can see, I can select the text underneath the image. The events go right through. And that's it. This was actually, we've added this to fix a real life problem that Atlas had with some of the applications that they were using this in a slightly different context, but they had basically like a field of buttons and they wanted to just put some title text on top of it but still have the buttons react to input. Okay, so. Right, next example is context menus, in particular touch selection. And I actually wanted to start with the demo for this, so I'll go back to do something else. This time I'll bring up GDK Widget Factory, which is another one of our versatile demo applications that have an example for everything. So let me see how I do this. So I was going to write to show the touch version of this, and of course I'm running into the same complication that I discovered the last time I wanted to demonstrate touch features that I can touch over there. So. So now I'm showing you the mouse click version of this. So I've clicked here with the mouse and you get the context menu. What I wanted to show is that you can actually add your own items to these context menus that GDK provides. In this little example, I added some simple text formatting things, so you can actually enable or disable this. And as you can see, the text actually reacts to that, so this is it's really implemented. And let me see if I can actually demonstrate the touch version of this using GDK Inspector. We're really going into the unscripted territory, and I hope this works. GDK Inspector lets you simulate touch screens. There's a switch for this somewhere here. There it is. I managed to switch this, but hopefully all my mouse clicks will be interpreted as touch events. And oh, they are actually. Let's see if this works. So one other thing to see here is these touch handles here. Now my mouse clicks are get interpreted as touch events. So we actually show you the touch selection interface here. And for touch, our selections have these big, easily touchable handles, which are nice. And if I right click in here, I still get okay, so there it is. Left click works. So this is the touch selection version of the context menu. You see we show pop over there. And what you also see is that the same UI that I the same three widgets that I same menu items that I had in the menu show up here in the pop over as well. They look slightly different here because they are actually real button widgets now. And that was kind of the point of what I wanted to show here. I'll go back to my slides one more time. There it is. So for extending these context menus, you connect to this populate popper signal. I talk here about the GDK text view. Populate pop-up signal, but there's the same signal for for GTK Entry, and there's also one for GTK Places sidebar. So multiple places let you basically extend context menus in the same way. You select this, connected a signal, and then you have a callback that does some things. Now, what I want to point out here is that this is an old signal. GTK 2 already let you do this. But back in GTK 2 days, there was no touch version of the selection. It was always a menu. So the callbacks that people wrote back then to connect to the signal, we're all expecting that there would be passed a GTK menu there. And for that reason, to preserve backwards compatibility, I added a separate property here, this Boolean property called populate all. And you have to set that to true if you want to receive the populate pop-up signal also in cases where it's a popover instead of a menu. Because your signal handler has to be prepared for handling something other than the menu. And I try to indicate that here to show this GTK's menu check. So if what you get is not a menu, then you're in the touch selection case and you want to use suitable widgets for that. And yeah, I already mentioned that this works both for GTK entry and for GTK text view, and it also works in things like GTK places sidebar. I believe Nautilus actually uses that to add some menu items to the sidebar. Okay, moving on to the next example. Spin buttons, another old-time GTK widget that everybody has seen and many have probably used. And spin buttons use adjustments, GTK adjustment as a model for their data. And adjustment is essentially a numeric thing. It's like a range. Like you have a minimum, lower end, lower boundary, you have an upper boundary, and you have a numeric value somewhere in between those two. But just that the model is based on numbers doesn't mean that the input and output of spin buttons has to be numeric in all cases. You can actually adjust what you want to see there, and I was going to show a quick demo of that before I dive into how you implement it. So, let's close this one again and go back to GTK demo. So here's a small example showing different forms of spin button. The first one is the one that everybody has seen, traditional. You just get numbers in and out. Next one shows some formatting. You can actually show the numbers hexadecimal if you want. The third one is a little more exotic maybe. This one shows something formatted as a time. The last one just gives you months of the calendar. And maybe I should actually just stay with this demo here and show the input side of this as well. So you can format the value on the output side, but you can also handle the input side, and you can accept something like 23 minutes past one. And on the far right, you see that it's actually the value is still like a simple number, it's 83, but we have a little input handling function that knows how to interpret this thing here, string here. And it's maybe more interesting in this last example here, where you can type something like MAR, you get March, or you can type December, you get December. So that's a fancy spin button. Going back to the slides, I want to quickly show how you implement those. So for the output side, there's a output signal on GTK spin button, and it just expects you to get the value of the adjustment, so we get the value there, and then we just, depending on what kind of output we want, we just find a suitable string, and then we call GTK and reset text with a suitable output. And since we're doing this in the signal handler for the output signal, the GTK spin button knows that like the change of the entry here is not actually user input, but it's just us formatting the value, so it won't get into like an infinite recursion at least, but we're fine. And on the input side, there's a similar signal for input, not too surprisingly. And yeah, it also has a signal handler where you where you get the current text out of the entry, and then you try to interpret it, and if you find what the user wanted to get out of it, you translate that into a double value, and you return that by using this output parameter in UL and kind of omitted the function declaration. You see that, but that's how it works. Interesting difference here is that for input handling, it might also be that the user just typed gibberish, so in that case you actually want to return GTK input error to tell the spin button that you could not make sense of that input. True means, like up here I return true, that means I handled that input and I gave you the right value to use. False means I didn't handle it, just use the next signal handler. It's a signal, so there can be multiple handlers. It's an int, I guess. Sorry, the question was what the return type is, and I believe it just returns int, but it only handles string values here, so. Playing fast and loose with C after all. Okay, so moving on. Next example here is scales. Everybody has seen scales and used scales in the UI. So they're really bread and butter widgets, nothing to it. You can actually make scales more interesting, and GTK can support you there. So one case that I want to call out here is that if you, as I said, like as for spin button scales, also use an adjustment as the data model, so you have continuous range, like lower boundary, upper boundary, and the value can be anything in between. But in many cases, maybe you only have like five values that make sense. And it probably helps if you don't confuse the user by offering them this continuous choice, but instead like giving feedback that there's a certain number of values that you can accept. One thing you can do is you can add these little marks, little lines underneath the scale to show where those values are. And I'll switch back to demonstrating this live before showing how you implement it. Oh, I see what's going on. Okay, another small example, three scales here. Increasing level of fanciness. Like the first one is plain one, as I said, continuous set of values, you can put it anywhere. And this one down here helps you a little bit by adding these marks below the scale. And if you move your mouse slowly here, you will feel that the marks have a little bit of stickiness to them, like the slider sticks there for a little bit to help you actually hit the mark exactly. And that's good and fine, but you can still select values in between. And just as a side remark here, you can also add labels to those marks. You can like show a little text below them that like, says which value this is. I wanted to talk about discrete values. So down here, this last example goes a step further. Not only has these marks, it also basically doesn't let you make any choices in between. So the slider will jump from one possible value to the next. So might come in handy at some point. And I think actually the concrete example that I, or the concrete use case that I took this idea out of was Nautilus. If you recall Nautilus in its gear menu or hamburger menu has this zoom slider which has three possible values. So that's where the idea came from. But this is not new technology, this has been possible with GTK2 already. And all you have to do for making this kind of discrete scale is just set the round digits property on the scale to zero, which basically tells GTK to round to whole numbers. You could also set it to one and then it would round to like tens. So, yeah. Alright, next example, switching to text and formatting of text. First one is about markup. That's something that people have asked for many, many times. They just want to like have this text that has some Pango markup in it. Pango has this small but very practical markup language that you can use to like make text by tablet or make it bold or things like that. And GTK text you just couldn't do anything with that until very recently. We finally added a function for this. That's called GTK text buffer insert markup. Not too surprising. And it does what the name implies. inserts Pangle markup and interprets it leaflet. And it lets you do Pangle markup, actually lets you do some exotic things, like you can have colorful underlines, or you can do letter spacing, or you can like select certain open type font features. And I'll show you how that looks. So this is my quick cheat sheet of all the possible Pango markup features. As you can see up there, the top row shows you like the various predefined text sizes that Pango markup gives you. There's the next row shows you how to set text colors. And there's colorful underlines and various kinds of underlines. I think the first one is a double underline, and the next one is a single one. There's strike-throughs, there's superscripts and subscripts, which let you do fancy math formulas if you tweak it a little. Letter spacing. OpenType font features is a thing that we landed in Pango also fairly recently this cycle. And if you look closely, you can see here, it's the same font actually, but here we have no ligature, and here over here we turned on discretionary ligatures, so you get this little hook that connected the S and the T. So that's interesting. And the last line just basically repeats what you had above. Pango markup has a bunch of shortcuts for this, and down there I'm just using the shortcuts instead of the generic version. Let me quickly show you how that actually looks in plain text. So this is the source file that I loaded into the text over there. And yeah, Pango markup. It's XML, so more beautiful. More on text. This one is a little fancier than what I just showed. So Pango is what does all our text layout. All the features you saw in the previous demo were basically what Pango gives us. But Pango and Cairo together can do great things. Pango has this function called Pango Cairo layout pass, which takes like a Pango layout, basically a bit of text. And instead of rendering it onto a Cairo surface, it just turns it into a path, and then you can use whatever Cairo API you want to like do whatever you want with that path. And the demo will show one way to use this technology. And I wanted to like tell a little story before I actually show the demo. So I wrote this demo when I was at the West Coast Hackfest recently in San Francisco, and so I arrived on Sunday afternoon, and it turned out it was the Sunday of the gay pride parade, and I totally had blacked out on that coincidence. So I got into the bar and I drove down to Powell Station, and I came out of the train, and it was like basically immersed in a sea of rainbow colors and dancing people, totally unexpectedly. And that might have influenced the choice of my pattern. So what I mean. So there you have it, rainbow colors. And if you beside the window, stretch out the text will stay like this. So that's probably something that you do not want to overuse in your application, but for like a welcome page or something. I'll defer to Alan, the designers here, for like using this wisely. Yeah, before we go on, I also wanted to say this is the Pango Cairo layout pass function is not super efficient, so you don't want to use this for a large corpus of text, but like for a headline or something, that's not a concern. And that might have some fun with it. Okay, last, or almost last group of examples I have is templates. templates have been, I think, a success story for GTK 3. We introduced them a few years ago, and they are really very handy. You probably all have used Glade or used UI files if you have written GTK applications before. And templates are just a way to nicely integrate UI files into like defining your own derived widget classes, make that very very easy and convenient. GTK basically uses this for all its own internal widgetry nowadays, and it works great. And it really reduces the amount of like boilerplate code you have to do to write to like set up your own like child labels and put them in boxes and arrange them rightly. It's all done in the XML file, and you can actually edit them with Glade, so you can actually change GTK file chooser by like opening the right template in Glade and make changes there. And I try to like find a few things here that even if you've used UI files before, you may not know that GTK Builder and UI files can do for you. The first one I came up with is that you can actually set up signal handlers and templates. And here's how that looks. Basically, you just use the signal element. Like if you have like a unified button inside your UI file, you can put this one line here to for the click signal associated with a handler called click callback. And then the question is, how does GTK Builder actually find that callback at runtime? And the answer is that you can use this little function down here, or it's actually a macro, I believe, called GTK widget class bind template callback, which lets you, if GTK Builder, this callback function down there is the one that you want to have. If you don't do that, then I believe GTK Builder will try to like find it by looking up symbols, and it might work without that. But inside GTK itself, we really use that bind template callback for everything in this area. Okay, more exciting things that you can do in templates, you can actually set up property bindings without writing a line of code. Here's how that looks. You all know that you can set properties of objects in the UI file, but basically you have this property element and you give a name, and then in the content of the element you specify the value. But sometimes you don't actually want to specify a fixed value, but you want to bind the property to some other property of some other object, and this is what you do. If you want to do that, then you do it by making the element empty, so you don't state a value here, but instead you specify these other attributes, bind source, bind property, and optionally some flags. And then GTK Builder will do all the legwork behind the scenes to create a, I don't know what that's called, it's a G binding object that implements all that for you. And yeah, that's really handy. And sometimes you run, if you want to use these property bindings, you run into the problem that you're inside a template, so the template is just in the middle of defining an object, but you want to already refer to properties of this object that is in the process of being defined. So you can actually do that. That looks like this. So if you're in a template, say for the GTK file chooser widget, then you can refer to this object, like the object that's being defined, as in the bind source by specifying that. And that allows you to bind properties of the widget that the template is for with some properties of this child widgets, which is surprisingly often what you need. Last thing for templates is you can also create anchor attributes and form a text that way. That if you use GTK Builder Marker for anchor attributes, it looks like this. So you say you have a label and you put some text in there, and you want text to be big and bold, and then you specify attributes for that. And that's not quite the same as specifying the anchor marker inside the text of the label. But if you do it this way, you don't have to, I could have just put a bold tag inside here, but then I would have to escape the angle brackets so that it doesn't get interpreted by the builder as XML. And that looks really ungainly and unseemly. So this is an alternative if you, it's particularly useful if you just want to specify attributes for the whole text. And this is really easy to do. All right. Last example switches orders again. This is about tree view models and complexity that comes with those. So one of those complexities that you might have seen in applications already is filtering. We have a filter model, GTK filter model for that. And you probably have used that for actual filtering, but for instance, if you implement like a search entry where you want to like filter down the amount of content that gets shown in the tree view, a filter model is the right thing to do that. But filter models cannot just filter, they can also do something else. They can invent new columns, so to speak, and I'll just show a demo of that. So here we have three tree views. The first one here on the top left corner is the original, which basically uses the list store model, which has three rows in it and two columns, like a width column and a height column. And down here, I use a filter model on top of that. I wrap the original model with the filter model, and only I think I filtered out everything that has a width that's greater than 5, so only one row remains here. That's the traditional use of a filter model that everybody knows. And here on the right, what I did instead is I used a different filter model, and I made the filter model basically invent two new columns, as you can see here. Like there's four columns here. The width and the height are basically passed straight through from the original underlying model. And then for the area column, I just calculate the area, and for the square, I just compare whether the two dimensions are the same and pass that boolean along. So this is not a very deep example, and it's not necessarily the only way to like implement this kind of thing, but sometimes it might come in handy to know that you can actually just use a filter model to compute extra content that you didn't have any underlying model. And that's my last example. Back to my slides. And just want to ask if anybody has questions about this, feel free to ask me now. But you're also free to come to our GTK team meeting on Monday morning. I believe you have like 2 or 3 hours booked for that, so there will be plenty of time to talk about more roadmap-y stuff that I didn't want to do here in the talk this year. And I guess we will also spend some time talking about GSK that Emmanuel showed earlier today. So you're all welcome to come there if you're interested. And another thing I wanted to say before opening up for questions is that all the examples that I showed here are available in GTK 3 demo, in the current master branch of GTK. Actually, a bunch of the demos were written in preparation for this talk, so I hope they are available for you whenever you want to see them. Right, any questions? Yes.
Okay, so just two quick things. One, I was curious about the open type text attributes, the ligatures that you mentioned. Is that on by default, or
Actually, I passed that question on right to Bedard.
I'll ask the other one first then. Okay. When you specify a property binding in the GTK builder, can you also specify a custom callback for the binding transformation in the same way that you specify, let's say, like a callback for the click button?
I'm not sure. I don't think that's possible. But it would be fairly easy to add, I guess. I mean, you just have to have a callback attribute or something and then interpret that properly. For now, I think the GTK builder just supports the non-custom bindings, basically. Whatever you get, if you use, and you can still influence the kind of binding by using the flags. Like you can set up a bidirectional binding or a unidirectional binding, or you can like I think there's a flag for inverting booleans, but fully custom callbacks. So we could add that if you had a patch for that. I would merge that over time.
Okay, thanks.
And maybe Bidar, did you answer that question?
We in Mango we've been doing open type features by default forever. What is feature the value is adding API to enable or disable further features from the user side of things.
Okay. So the ligatures would have been on by default.
Yeah, yeah,
definitely.
Any more questions?
I have. I wanted to ask this, and now it's a good time. So, as I said at the beginning, the challenge was to like show something that's new, at least one thing that's new for everybody in the room. So, who here in the room knew all the things I showed today, like knew that GTK could do this? All right, hey. Thank you.
Waters, and I have 5 minutes.